So I'm going to add just a little more to all these things that you've heard. I want to tell you about an anecdote. I was once talking to some students in a high school, just some school kids, and I was talking about the sort of things that one likes to talk about, say to say like the joy of mathematics, there is mathematics everywhere, and so on. And then one student asked me, "Well, you said it's fun. Yes, it's fun. But will it remain fun if you have to do it for a living?" Not exactly in these terms, but something like this. So I thought it was a very good question, because it's like what Rajiv was just saying a moment ago about something, when it's an exam, then you won't have fun, when there is no, right? Now, okay, it's all fun to say that you can, it's all nice to say you'll have fun, but if you have to earn a salary from it, will it remain fun? In fact, I had a question: can one have fun and earn a living too in anything? I mean, right? So, I don't know, what do you think? Is it possible to have fun and earn a living too by whatever gives you fun? Yes? Yeah, so okay, let me have a show of hands. How many people think yes to this? Not bad. This is a brainwashed crowd, I think, right? So I think these people have really brainwashed you a lot. So, okay, so I think I would say yes to some extent and no to some extent. That's about all I would say. Because it's very, very hard to, because, you know, when you have to earn a living, there are directors sitting here, there are people, there are bosses, there are people, there are deadlines, there are problems, you know, and you have to earn a living. So there is some pain, but there is some fun too. So the question is one of, like he said, you know, the package, right? There are so many variables. So there is always some fun and some pain. Question is, can you maximize some fun and minimize the pain? Well, how far can you go? And I think this is where I think the prospects of a mathematical sciences career, I think, should be evaluated against. I think Rajiv has already talked about it as, can it be a career? Like he said, in terms of livelihood, yes. Certainly in one generation, I think it's a lot more comfortable. It's not that you're going to be on the streets, and it's not like you have to sit under a tree and wait for an apple to fall or grow a beard and, you know, do navel gazing. All that is not possible. I think, you know, all that is not necessary. One can actually make a comfortable living. I don't know what material comforts you want, but I think it's reasonable. In terms of being a part of a national, international community, yes, I would say I think this is a very important motivation, because certainly being in a research career, being, you know, of any theory, you know, research career, one of the big things is that you are really part of a very large community. And I think any practicing researcher will tell you that this is a very important motivation in your life, right? That somehow your world is really getting expanded to a community that cuts across boundaries, and just in terms of travel abroad, maybe travel to different places, going to different universities, different, you know, meeting many sets of interesting people. And I think this in itself is a motivation which we don't think that seriously about, as opposed to many other careers where this kind of opportunities, today of course with the internet is possible, there is perhaps more travel, but the sense of immense community building that can happen for a researcher truly in an international sense is something to take very seriously indeed. So if people want to ask more questions about it, but I think it can be a very important motivation. Time, already Rajiv mentioned it, enviably academics are envied because they have a lot of time for learning music, for doing many other things which other people cannot do. And freedom, right? Certainly, I think that, especially if you do exotic mathematics that nobody understands, the kind of freedom that you have is phenomenal, right? You can really set your agenda, right? And he was talking about highly applicable mathematics when people are knocking at your doors, desperately telling, give me a solution by tomorrow. But, you know, you can do really good mathematics and not worry that anyone will knock on your door at all, except other fellow mathematicians. But I think there is a tremendous sense of freedom, apart from bosses breathing down your neck, you know, in deadlines that, you know. So research as a career, I think these are very important, you know, this is a good, important lifestyle issue, I think. And then, I think this was not mentioned, okay, he was talking about excelling. But I also would like to add one important word of humility, which is that it's also feasible. You can actually do a good research career. Being brilliant is great, but it's not necessary, right? In fact, for me, I joined Tata Institute as a PhD student, and TIFR, when I joined, I thought they were all gods, right? Everybody walking around is a god. Because if you can prove your own theorems, you must be a god, right? I mean, this is what I thought. I mean, as a student, I thought you only learn other people's theorems, and that is hard enough. It was terrible trying to learn proofs of theorems that other people had proved. But to prove your own theorems, I thought you must be a god. It took a while to realize that all the gods had feet of clay as well, okay? Okay, so that is one important learning. And then travel. The great benefit of academic travel, going to conferences, meeting other people, that you learn that you're not the only idiot in the world. I mean, there are lots of idiots all around, lots of people, and you know, we are all part of the same thing, right? We're looking for something. There is occasional brilliance, there is occasional genius. Thankfully, once in a lifetime, some great person comes, and only once in a lifetime. Most of the people that you meet are clever, by half, stupid by half, but whatever. And so it's actually feasible. This is very important, because one of the students once asked me, you know, look, I'm very seriously interested in mathematics, but every time I look at Gauss, every time I look at Riemann, and then I say, no, come on, there's no way I can do any of this, right? Why the hell should I do this, right? So I want to say that, yes, look at Gauss and Riemann, it's extremely important, but look at me too, right? You know, so, right? So look at all of us around, and you can actually do it. So the last bit is extremely important, because it should not be thought that a career in mathematical sciences is only for the Gauss and Riemann, right? It's not clear to me that Riemann would have a successful career today. Maybe he'll be a decent professor. But in any case, I'm saying that you can do a pretty good job being good at what you're doing, and wanting to excel perhaps is very important, but there's no need to feel that this is only for the gods. The other one is, let me just mention one particular theme that I want to emphasize a little bit about. We already seen this word computer science and computing and all mentioned repeatedly. One is, I would say, the mathematics of computation. I think this is one very important, and already Rajiva has laid the ground to say that the area of mathematical sciences is very broad and it accommodates many kinds of creatures. There are all kinds of things possible. We have already had long lists of these. There is one particular thing that I want to mention, that's theoretical computer science, and mainly because that is what I practice. Full of exciting open problems, lots and lots of, I mean, it's actually a open problem driven culture, and many which some even can get you a large amount of money if you solve. But it's also the business of converting existence theorems to constructions. I mean, to take one example, the Brouwer fixed point theorem is very old in mathematics and something that everybody studies somewhere in the curriculum. It's a very important theorem, a beautiful theorem. But if you look at the proof of the theorem, right, it's highly, you know, whatever the proof that one learns of the Brouwer fixed point theorem is highly non-constructive. To come up with a construction to actually compute the Brouwer fixed point of function is something that was actually settled as recently about 6 years ago. Okay, the full complexity of it, and even that, the way it was settled is leaving enough doors open for at least, you know, another 20 years of research possible. So that's one example to tell you. So in fact, if you mine mathematics, there are any number of such existence theorems. From the existence to actually come up with an algorithm is a phenomenal task. And in fact, I would say the business of theoretical computer science is in fact converting these existence theorems to constructions and looking at complexity of them. And so this already suggests to you that there are many ways of looking at mathematics which can actually be fun and can get you a living. In fact, I would say that this is perhaps one that's likely to keep a large number of people busy in the next decades. I mean, this kind of approach of looking for constructive proofs and turning them into algorithms. I can give that Brouwer fixed point theorem I gave was one example. Actually, there are hundreds such that one can talk about. That is math of computing. This combination, I think, is perhaps going to be one of the most powerful in the new century, right? The ability to do computing here, I'm talking about facility with algorithms, software, programming, this kind of thing, and mathematics. So this dual skill, being good at mathematics alone or being good at computing alone, I think is not going to be enough, but this is going to be one of the most winning combinations, I think, for the new century. Just to list a few examples, math and calculus, the width I'm putting is some real expertise in computing. And here, once again, let me repeat, I mean not just programming, but algorithms as well, or both. And so expertise in computing and calculus is exactly what science and engineering want. In fact, the way the practice of science and engineering, the scientific computation, the way it is changing, is that this is the expertise that's going to be most needed in for quite some time to come. And we are barely scratching the surface as of now. But number theory, okay, at least cryptography is one area where you can say, but this combination of computing and number theory is opening up many, many interesting things, including data mining, one of the things that Tajio was talking about. In many areas that this, what would, you know, even 20, 30 years ago, people would have thought of it as a very unlikely combination, but today it's actually immensely important. With geometry, well, we already heard a talk in robotic arm design, and actually in computer vision, a range of applications where working with computing and geometry is extremely important. With algebra, okay. Now, this is one area where perhaps applications and technology are expanding very fast. And perhaps I would say the biggest one is probability, right? People with great expertise in computing and probability theory and statistics, these are perhaps perhaps right now the biggest demand and that you can think of. So this is only, and then with graph theory and combinatorics, to me this opens into the whole world of optimization and all the algorithmic applications that come from these. So I'm here trying to say that perhaps in terms of prospects and careers, if you want to talk, it's not one skill, right? It's one thing to be open-minded. Perhaps two skills are essential. Something to do, something related to computing, a strong skill there, and a strong mathematical ability in some area of mathematics is something that can be a very important and winning combination. You should not, this used to be said that learning mathematics prepares you only to teach mathematics, and I think something like that Rajiv mentioned as well. But then what about math teaching? Why not? That is a good career in itself, right? Should one not worry about that? I would say yes. In fact, I think this is not taken seriously enough. And perhaps I would say that one of the important problems of this country is that math education to be taken as a serious career option, as and what kind of potential there is. And this is going to become perhaps more and more important as we go along, because this is a huge demand and an increasing demand all over the world, not only in this country, in terms of specific new research institutes, new universities, but in this country, if you do any projections at all, right, you're going to talk about any number of universities opening up, any number of institutions of higher learning opening up within this, within perhaps the next 2 decades. And the same thing is happening all over the world. And if there is one area where there is unanimous agreement all over the world, it's the need for math teachers. The need for good mathematics teachers is something that you hear about, whether it's Somalia or United States or Europe or Asia. Anyway, this is the litany that you hear, right? So somewhere society recognizes that it's extremely important and also realizes that what is being done is not good enough. I would say that mathematics education as a career is something that is not, and this is being talked about in the light of new resources and new opportunities. Tomorrow there is a session with Amritamshu talking about online resources for learning mathematics, but I think also for teaching mathematics. And the kind of potential that exists now, or at least opening up now, which you can barely see, right, with the kind of technological possibilities on one hand, presentational possibilities, sharing information, sharing course notes, material, interaction across the world, you know, open courseware. I think the shape of mathematics education is can change, and being the drivers of change, it will require enormous understanding of mathematics to begin with. I mean, and not just all this technology. So I think this in itself is something to take very seriously, and I think it can be a big money spinner too. Okay, I think, of course, that's not big news at the level of schools today, because anyone who does math tuition at higher secondary level is can earn probably much more than most of these industrial opportunities that Rajiva was talking about. But what I'm trying to point out is that at higher education at all levels, quality mathematics instruction is actually a proper a major business opportunity as well, and it's something to think about. So I would say that learning mathematics equips you in more ways than that. and math and the world. Rajiv has already talked a lot about that. So I just wanted to mention that this year is called the year of mathematics for the planet Earth. Okay, so that's what it's called, and there are various things happening around the world in relation to that. This is to celebrate the use of mathematics, especially in areas like ecology and environment, for the protection of the Earth. In climate studies, in glacier studies, enormous number of environment-related studies, today mathematics is the language in which a lot of the work is being carried out in terms of model building, how it is applied. So I thought this is something to mention, because the reach that we are talking about is phenomenal. Mathematics and biology. This is the other very important one I would like to say, because for the new century, perhaps in science, some of the most exciting things happening in natural sciences are happening in biology today, and mathematics again is opening up ways of thinking that our traditional mathematics curricula don't do justice to, and this is again going to be a very important combination for the new century. Mathematics and finance, that already a lot has been talked about. Then mathematics and the social sciences, especially to make the world better in some way, right? Anytime we go outside and look at the traffic, we all think, you know, can't we do something about this, right? Urban planning. Urban planning is a very important area where mathematics is being applied in very important ways today. Traffic studies, energy studies, and you know, one can list quite a lot. But I'm just talking about the kind of opportunities for thinking of career in combinations that we could never think about maybe even a decade ago. Let me end with a quote. Okay, so the quote is, says, the advancement and perfection of mathematics are intimately connected with the prosperity of the state. It's a very famous line. Does anyone know who this quote is from? Any guess? Who could say something like this? Huh? Let's ask, it doesn't matter, the name is not important. What kind of person said this? Was it a mathematician?
I don't think so.
You don't think so? Okay. Any other guess? Who could have said this? Film star? Politician? Maths teacher? Yeah? Sorry? Somebody in economics, okay?
Some founding father of some nation.
Wow. Napoleon. Okay, so, and this is an extremely important statement, and this was at the time of the founding of the École Normale Supérieure, and in Paris, and Napoleon was very keen on this. And by the way, these schools, the Grande École at the time, was set up in France for a very important reason: to produce teachers of mathematics. That was the main aim at the time. Not just mathematics and the sciences, but mathematics was considered extremely important, and producing teachers of mathematics was considered important, and the École Normale, its main aim was to produce a large number of people who can actually go and teach mathematics later on, right? And on this occasion, well, it was not on this occasion, it was before that, but Napoleon, you know, had some things to say about what the state should do, and he says explicitly that the advancement and perfection of mathematics are actually intimately connected to the development of the state. So I would say that this may come from a very long time ago, but represents the spirit of modernity for the 21st century in perhaps ways that people could not have understood at the time. Okay, thank you.